Good morning. Today we'll start with a topic that is the engine emissions and their control. We will start with compression ignition engines, how to control the pollution in compression ignition engine. So the same, you can use either catalytic converter or you can use exhaust gas recirculations. So we will start with the first, the particulate traps. Compression ignition engine systems are equipped with particle traps in their exhaust flow to reduce the amount of particulates released to the atmosphere. Traps are filter-like systems often made of ceramic in the form of a monolith or mat or else made of metal wire mesh. Traps typically remove 60 to 90% of particulates in the exhaust flow. So carbon soot particles ignite at 500 to 650 degrees Celsius. While CI engine exhaust is 100 to 350 degrees Celsius. So what we can do, because later stage, the trap will become a, you can say, restriction to the flow. You can say the, as traps catch soot particles, they slowly fill up and with the particles. So this restricts exhaust flow and raises the back pressure of the engine. Although we had trapped the particles for preventing to the environment, but they will cause a problem here. They will increase the back pressure of engine. So higher back pressure causes the engine to run hotter and exhaust temperature rise and fuel consumption increases. To reduce this, what we have to do, to reduce the flow restriction, particulate traps are regenerated when they begin to saturate. Regeneration consists of combustioning the particulates in the excess of oxygen contained in exhaust of a lean operating CI engine. So we will burn those particles which are trapped, and then we can reuse it. So in some systems, automatic flame igniters are used, which start combustion in the carbon when the pressure drop across the trap reaches a predetermined value. So what we have a pressure measuring system which will measure the pressure drop across the engine and trap. So at some time igniter will start and it will burn all those particles. These igniters can be electric heaters or flame nozzles that use diesel fuel. If a catalyst material is installed in the traps, the temperature needed to ignite the carbon soot is reduced to 350 to 450 degrees Celsius. Some such traps can automatically regenerate by self-igniting when the exhaust temperature rises from increased back pressure. So there are a few automatic arrangements also. When the back pressure increases, the traps will self-ignite and they will burn all those particles to clear the path of the gases. Another way of lowering the ignition temperature of the carbon soot and promoting self-regeneration in traps is to use catalyst additives in the diesel fuel. These additives generally consist of copper compounds or iron compounds with about 6 to 8 grams of additive in 1000 liters of fuel is usually normal to keep the temperatures high enough to self-regenerate in a catalytic system. Traps can be mounted as close to the engine as possible, even before the turbocharger. On some large stationary engines and on some construction equipment and large trucks, the particle trap is replaced when it becomes close to filled position. The removed traps is then regenerated externally with the carbon being burned off in the furnace. The regenerated trap can then be used again. So various methods are used to determine when soot build up, because excessive and regeneration is unnecessary. The most common method is to measure the pressure drop in the exhaust flow as it passes through the trap. When a pressure predetermined pressure drop delta P is reached, the regeneration is initiated. So also we can use radio waves, that is one other method. Another method used to sense soot buildup is to transmit radio frequency waves through the trap and determine the percent that is absorbed. Carbon soot absorbs radio waves while the ceramic structure does not. The amount of soot buildup can therefore be determined by the percentage decrease in radio signal. This method does not readily detect soluble organic fraction. So this is the methods. Next is in your modern diesel engine, how we increase the formation of soot particles and other emissions. So with greatly increased mixing efficiency and speeds, large uses of fuel rich mixtures can be avoided when combustion starts. So you can say here in this chapter, in this Para will discuss that with the design, proper design of engine, like with the indirect injection, or you can say battery combustion chamber geometry, battery injector design and higher pressures using heated spray targets and rear assisted injectors can lead to the better working of engine without production of soot particles and other pollutants. Indirect injection into a secondary chamber that promotes high turbulence at work, greatly speeds the air fuel mixing process. Better nozzle design and higher injection pressures create finer fuel droplets when evaporate and mix quicker. Injection against a hot surface speeds evaporation as do air assist injectors. So the next is reducing emission by chemical methods. There are other methods which can reduce pollution, or you can say the formation of you can say unburnt or soot particles. That is reducing emissions by chemical methods. So development work has been done on large stationary engines using cyanuric acid to reduce NOx emissions. Cyanuric acid is a low cost solid material that sublimates in the exhaust flow. The gas dissociates, producing isocyanate that reacts with NOx to form nitrogen, water and CO2. Operating temperature is about 500 degrees Celsius. Up to 95% NOx reduction can be achieved with no loss of engine performance. Another method is your ammonia injection system. Here you can see here some large marine engines and station engine reduce NOx emission with an injection system that sprays ammonia into the exhaust flow. You can see ammonia after reacting with the nitrogen monoxide and oxygen, it will form you can see diatomic molecule nitrogen and water, which are stable, and same this ammonia reacting with this will form nitrogen and water. So it will produce convert those harmful and NOx nitrogen dioxide and monoxide into this stable products. So ammonia injection system are not practical in automobiles or on other smaller engines. This is because of needed ammonia storage and fairly complex injection and control system, because it is also, again, ammonia is harmful for human beings and it is difficult to store, so we won't use in small engines. Next is your exhaust gas recirculation. So exhaust gas recirculation, we will discuss it. You can see here what is the benefit of exhaust gas recirculation, why we are using. The main purpose here is to reduce the operating temperature of engine. You can see here we can use CO2, EGR, nitrogen, helium and argon. We can use this all to reduce the you can say overall temperature of the engine. We can mix argon, we can mix helium, we can mix nitrogen with the inlet air fuel mixture, we can mix exhaust gas, and as well we can mix CO2. But you can see CO2 has the more specific heat, so the amount of you can say moles needed dilute is less as compared to argon. Argon specific heat is you can say less, so it will more argon amount, more amount of argon gas is needed to maintain the engine temperature low. But neither argon is available to us, neither helium, and neither other gases, or neither CO2 is available in the isolated form. So we use the exhaust gas which is burned in the previous cycle. We will use this previous cycle gas in the new cycle to dilute that air fuel mixture and to decrease the overall working temperature of the engine. Okay. So we will start from here. The most effective way of reducing NOx emission is to hold combustion chamber temperatures down. Although practical, this is very unfortunate method in that it is also reduce thermal efficiency of the engine. Those who have undergone thermodynamic course are aware that obtaining maximum engine efficiency is we need a higher temperature possible. Probably the simplest and practical method of reducing maximum frame temperature is to dilute the air fuel mixture with a non-reacting parasite gas. This gas absorbs energy during combustion without contributing any energy input. The net result is lower frame temperature. Any non-reacting gas would work as a dilutant, as shown in figure we had discussed earlier. Those gases with larger specific heats would absorb the most energy per unit mass and would therefore require the least amount. Thus, less CO2 would be required than argon for the same maximum temperature. However, neither CO2 nor argon is readily available for the use in engine. Air is available as a dilutant, but it is not totally non-reacting. Adding air changes the air-fuel ratio also. So what we use, the one non-reacting gas that is released used in the exhaust is the engine exhaust gas, and this is used in all modern engines. And adding any non-reacting neutral gas to the inlet air fuel mixture reduces flame temperature and oxygenation. So exhaust gas recirculation is the one gas that is readily available for engine use. So exhaust gas recirculation is done by ducting some of the exhaust flow back into the intake system, usually immediately after the throttle. The amount of flow can be as high as 30% of the total intake. Exhaust gas recirculation combines with the exhaust residue left in the cylinder from the previous cycle to effectively reduce the maximum combustion temperature. The flow rate of exhaust gas recirculation is controlled by the engine management system. You can see this is your exhaust gas recirculation, and it is equal to mass of exhaust gas recirculated divided by mass of cylinder, and this is the percentage. We can change the percentage of exhaust gas circulation depending on the requirement. The amount of exhaust gas recirculation is controlled by engine management system. By sensing inlet and exhaust conditions, the flow is controlled, ranging from 0 or up to 50 to 30%. Lowest NOx emissions with relatively good fuel economy occur at about stoichiometric combustion, with as much EGR as possible without adversely affecting combustion. No EGR is used during wide open throttle when maximum power is desired. A problem unique to compression engine when using EGR is the solid carbon soot present in the exhaust. They will create a problem. The soot acts as an abrasive and breaks down the lubricant. Greater wear and tear of the piston rings and valve train results. We use EGR, but as we know, EGR may contain some soot particles, and that soot particle will act as a abrasive material in the next cycle, and it will wear down the lubricant. So this is a problem here. So this is in the video up to here, the exhaust emissions and they are controlled, how to control these exhaust emissions, these are different methods. In the next class we will come video, we will come up with a new topic. Like this video, subscribe my channel, and thank you for watching this video.